I'd just like to remind you some of the signs that say that there will be some strobe lighting effects tonight. Ooh, exciting. And there will also be a couple of loud bangs. Okay, so be ready. You will be deafened, but only temporarily, I hope. Okay, just to remind you all, please, could you make sure that your mobile phones, especially those of you who are teenagers, are turned off for the performance. Really appreciate that. Thanks very much. The performance will now begin.
There's a bullet in the gun. Thank you.
tell me so.
Will you adapt, sir, that you asked her?
Signor Benedict knows when you're a child.
Signor Leonardo, if we have Barbara, it's a good job. She hasn't inherited his good looks, eh?
I wonder who'll still be talking, Signor Benedict, because nobody's listening.
What, my dear, are you disdain? Are you yet living?
Is it possible disdain should die while she has such meat food to feed it as Signor Benedict? Even courtesy itself would be rude.
Then it's courtesy and turncoat, for it's certain I am loved of all ladies, only to accept it. And I would, I could find in my heart, that I had not a heart of, but truly I love none.
A dear happiness to a woman, she would have been suffered with a pernicious suitor. I thank you, Jordan, my poor love, and your humour for that. I'd rather hear my dog box crow than the man swear he loves me.
God keep your ladyship to the end, for some gentleman should escape there, scratch the face.
Scratching could not make it worse than the squire face is your worst.
Well, you are a red parrot, teacher.
A bird of my tongue is better than a beast.
I'll win my horse out to bring you your time. We'll have it your own way. I'm done.
You're meant for Jane's trick. I know you're old.
John, Signor Benedict, Signor Claudio. Leonardo has invited us all, and I will tell you we'll stay here for at least a month.
Welcome, my lord. Being reconciled with the prince, your brother, I owe you all duty.
I thank you. I'm not a man of many words, but thank you.
Notice Hero, Leonardo's daughter.
I noted her not, but I looked on her.
Is she not a modest young lady?
Do you question me as an honest man would do for a single true judgment, or would you have me speak after my custom and being a best tyrant to their sex?
No, I pray you speak in sober judgment.
Why? Faith, you think she's too low for a high praise, too brown for a fair praise, and too little for a great praise? Only this commendation I can afford her. The worse she other than she is, she were unhandsome. Being honest, but as she is, I do not like her.
You think I'm joking? I tell you, pray, take this. Tell me truly, how you like her?
Did you buy her, did you inquire?
Can the world buy such a jewel?
Yea, a case to put it into. But speak you this beside brow?
In my eye, she is the sweetest lady that ever I looked on.
I can still see without spectacles, and I see no such matter. Now her cousin Beatrice, if she were not possessed with a fury, would exceed you as much in beauty as the first of May or the last of December. But I hope you have no intent to turn husband, have you?
I would scarce trust myself. Oh, I had sworn the contrary, if Hera would be my wife.
Is it come to this? Shall I never see a bachelor of 80 again? Don Pedro is returned to seek you.
What secret have you held here? Did you follow not to Leonardo?
Please don't let him tell you.
I charge you, on your allegiance to me, your leader.
Claudio, you know I can keep a secret like a dumb man. But on my allegiance to our leader, he is in love. With who? With Hero, Leonardo's short daughter.
If you love her, the lady is very well worthy.
You speak this to fetch me in, my lord.
Honestly, I'm serious.
Truly, so am I. Honestly and truly, me too.
Shut up! Did I love her?
She's worthy, I know.
But I need to fear how she should be loved, not how she should be worthy. It is the opinion that fire will not melt out of me. I will die at the stake.
You're always a heretic when it comes to beauty.
That a woman conceived me, I thank her. That she brought me up, I likewise give her most humble thanks. But that I will hang my bugle in an invisible baldric, all women shall pardon me. I will live a bachelor.
Before I die, I shall see you look pale with love.
With anger, with sickness, or with hunger, my lord. But not with.
Well, as time will tell, in time the savage bull doth bear the yoke.
Savage bull may, but if ever the sensible Benedict bear it, pluck off the bull's horns and set them in my forehead, and let me be vilely painted in such great letters as they write, girls, 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 let them signify under my sign, that you may see Benedict, the married man!
Prepare to Leonardo's and commend me, let him know that I will not fail him at supper, for he has made a great preparation.
Examine your consciences, and so I leave you.
Right, now to business.
Have Leonardo any sons, my lord?
No child but Hero. She's his own heir. Why, do you care for her, Claudia?
Oh, my lord. When we went forward on this end of action, I looked upon her with a soldier's eye, that liked, that had a rougher task in hand than to drive liking for the name of love. But now we are returned. And warthogs have left their places vacant. In their rooms come thronging soft and
here with the Book of Words. You love their hero, cherish it. I'll broach the subject with her and her father, Leonardo, and you will have... I know we'll have some reveling tonight, and I'll assume your part in some disguise and tell fair hero I am Claudio. Then in her bosom I'll unclasp my heart and take her hearing prisoner for my fourth and strong encounter of my amorous tale. And I'll talk to her father, and the conclusion is she shall be yours. He's quite...
Where did you go?
get that gun?
I have one.
Let's go.
Thank you.
Count neither sad, nor sick, nor merry, nor well, but civil count.
hero is won. I've spoken to her father and he's good with the pain. Name the day of marriage and God give you joy.
Now claim to me my daughter and with her my fortune. His grace has made the match of all grace. Say amen to it.
Amen.
Speak out as your cue.
Silence is the most perfect herald of joy. If I could say how much I were but a little happy. Lady, as you are mine, I am yours.
Speak, cousin, or if you cannot, stop his mouth with a kiss so he can't speak either.
Aww. You have a merry heart, lady.
Yea, I thank you for all. Keep me away from care. My cousin tells him, in his ear, that he is in her heart.
So she doth, cousin.
Thank the good Lord for relatives. And thus goes everyone into the world but I. I see that I'm attractive, and I might sit in the corner and cry, I hope for a husband.
Lady Beatrice, I will get you one.
I'd rather one of your father's getting. Has your grace near a brother like you? Your father produces excellent husband material.
Have me, then.
No. Your grace is far too costly to wear every day. But I beseech your grace, pardon me. I was born to speak all mirth and no matter.
Silence most offends you. Be merry best it comes you, but you were born in a merry hour.
No, sure, my lord. My mother cried, and then there was a stardust. And under that I was born. Cousin, God give you joy.
Truly a pleasant-spirited lady.
There is little of the melancholy element in her, my lord. She's never sad but when she sleeps, and not even so then. For I've heard my daughter say she has often dreamt of unhappiness and waked herself laughing.
She cannot endure talk of a husband.
Oh, by no means. She mocks all her wooers out of suit.
She were an excellent wife for Benedict.
Oh, my lord, if they were but a week married, they would talk themselves mad.
Count, when do you mean to go to church?
Tomorrow, my lord. Time goes on crutches till that, I thought, Christ.
Not till Monday, my dear son, which is just a week away, and time too brief, too, to get all things ready.
Come, come, you shake your head as I run away. But I assure you, time will not go dully by without. In the interim, I will undertake one of Hercules' labours, which is to bring Signor Benedict and Lady Beatrice into a mountain of affection, one with the other. I would gladly have it to match, and doubt not the passion. If you few of them minister such assistance as I give you direction.
My lord, I am to you, whatever it takes.
And I, my lord. And you two gentlemen?
Oh, dame, what is this, my lord, to help my cousin to get husband?
Benedict's not the most hopeless husband, you know. Thus far I've been praised him. He is noble, valiant, and honest. I will teach you how to humour your cousin so that she will fall in love with Benedict. Then I, with you two, will set to work on Benedict so that, despite his quick wit and queasy stomach, he shall fall in love with Beatrice. We can do this, then Cupid is no longer an archer. For we are the only lovers. Go in with me and I will tell you my drift.
Vex Claudia, undo here.
surely an after.
What more could you ask for? Only to spite them, I will endeavour and
go then. Find me a suitable way to draw Don Pedro and Count Claudio alone. Tell them you know Hero loves me. Pretend to kind of deal with both the Prince and Claudio, and say that you warned him because you would love your brother's honour for his latest match, and for his friend's reputation, for he's in danger of getting hit with the semblance of a mate. They'll scarcely believe this without evidence. Often believe with examples. Show me at Hero's balcony. I'll call Margaret Hero, and Margaret turn me Claudio this very night before the intended wedding. In the meantime, I'll so fashion them out that Hero shall be absent, and there shall be such seeming truth in Hero's disloyalty that jealousy shall be called assured and all preparation overthrown.
Grow this to what adverse issue it can. I will put it into practice. Be cunning in the working of this, and your fee will be £1,000.
Be constant in the accusations, and my cunning shall not shame them.
I will presently go and learn their day of marriage.
How I pray you.
You amaze me!
I would have thought that you should have been invincible against all the sorts of affection.
I would have sworn it had, my lord, especially against Benedict.
Oh, this can be Leonardo speaks it. Labry cannot surely hide himself in such reverence. He has taken the infection. Keep it going.
Has she made her affection known to Benedict?
No, and swear she never will. That's her torment.
True indeed, so your daughter says. Shall I, said Beatrice, who has so often encountered him with scorn, write to him that I love him?
This she said now, when she's beginning to write to him, though she'll be asked 20 times a night. There she will sit in her night until she's written a sheet of paper. My daughter tells us all.
Now you talk of a sheet of paper, I remember a pretty jest your daughter told herself.
Oh, when Beatrice had written it and Hero was reading it over, she found Beatrice and Benedict between the sheets of paper.
That's it.
Oh, she tore the letter into a thousand pieces. Well, she'd be so immodest to write to someone she knew would flout her. I measure him, she said, by my own spirit. But I should measure him if he were to write to me, yet, even though I love him, I should.
Then down upon her knees she falls, weeps, sobs, beats her heart, tears her hair, prays, curses. Oh, sweet Benedict, God, give me patience!
She does indeed. In fact, the frenzy has so much overtaken her that my daughter's afraid she might be a desperate outrage to herself.
Benedict should hear it from someone else if she will not disclose it.
To what end? He would like to make sport of it and torment the poor lady worse.
It would be a good deed to hang him. She's an excellent, sweet lady, and above all suspicion, she is virtuous.
And she is exceedingly wise.
In all but loving Benedict.
Oh, my lord, passion and wisdom combating in such a tender body. I have 10 proofs to 1 that passion has the victory. I'm sorry for my niece, as I've just caused, being her uncle and co-guardian.
I wish she had bestowed this much affection on me. I would have put aside all other considerations and made her my better half. I pray you tell Benedict of it and see what he will say.
Is it a good idea, do you think?
Hero thinks surely she will die. Well, she says she will die if he does not love her. And she says she will die if she writes to him that she loves him. And she will say she will die if he woos her, rather than give up one moment for her accustomed crosses.
She does well, for if she made an offer of her love, it's very possible he'll scorn it. And a man, as you all know, has a contemptible spirit.
He is a very handsome man.
He has some pleasing outward appearance.
Before God and in my mind, he is very wise.
He shows some sparks which are light-wit.
And I take him to be valiant?
As Hector, I assure you, for in the managing of quarrels, you may say he is wise. For he either avoids them with a great discretion or undertakes with the most Christian-like fear. Well, I'm sorry for your daughter. Shall we go and see Benedict and tell him of her love?
Never tell him, my lord. Give her good advice to help her get over it.
Nay, that's impossible. She never will.
Well, we'll hear further in from your daughter. Let's it cool for a while. I love Benedict well and wish he could modestly examine himself to see how unworthy he is of such a good lady.
Dinner is ready. Shall we walk?
Peter looked over on her after this. I will never trust my judgment again. At the same at this breath for Beatrice, your daughter and her ladies must do this. Let us make him consented to dinner by her.
This can be no trick. The conversation was a serious one.
They have the truth of this from Hero.
They seem to pity the lady. It seems her affection to stretch to the limit. Love me? Why? It must be requited. They say how I am condemned, and how I will bear myself proudly if I perceive the love coming from her. They say, too, that she would rather die than show me any sign of affection. I did never think to marry. But happier they would contend criticism, I'd be better for it. They say the lady is fair, it's a truth, and wise, but for loving me, and virtuous, if so, I cannot reprove it. And it be no addition to her wit, nor great argument to her folly, for I will be horribly in love with her. I may happen to have some odd quirks and remnants of wit broken upon me, for I have railed so long against marriage. But doesn't the appetite alter a man? sentences and paper bullets of the brain or a man in the course of his inclination?
No, the world must be peopled.
When I said I would die a bachelor, I did never think I would live till I were married.
Benedict!
Dear Beatrice.
Against my will, I am sent to bid you to come to dinner.
Thank you, my dear Beatrice.
I took no more pains for those thanks than you take pains to thank me. If it had been painful, I would not have come.
Then you take pleasure in this message.
Yea, just so much pleasure as you may take upon a knife's point. You have no stomachs and you're fairly well.
Against my will, I am sent to bid you come in to dinner. There's a double meaning in that. I took no more pains for those thanks than you take pains to thank me. It's as much as to say that any pains I take are as easy as thanks. If I do not pity her, I am a villain. If I do not love her, I am a fool. I will go follow her.
Thank you. state of the Americas consummated, then I'm off towards Arabia.
I'll go with you, my lord.
Hey,
don't
be
a great to stay with the costume of new marriage. Show the child his new coat, never been in to wear it. I'll only be bold with Benedict for his company, but he has twice or thrice cut Peter's bowstrings. He has a harp as sound as a bell, and his tongue is a clapper. For what his heart thinks, his tongue speaks.
Gallant, so I'm not as I have been.
No, me thinks you are sadder.
I hope he be in love.
Hang him, Drew. There be no true drop of blood in him to be touched with love. If he's sad, it's because he's short of cash.
I've a toothache. Draw it.
Oh, hang it.
You must hang it first and draw it afterwards.
Oh, what size for the toothache?
Yet say I.
He is in love. There is no appearance of fancy in him unless he be attacked with strange disguises. Mm-hmm. I shall be a Dutchman to see. A prime time for more. Or, in the shape of 2 pounds at once, a German from the big town. A fashion victim maybe, but in love.
If he is not in love with some woman, there is no believing old signs. He brushes his hair in the mornings, for example.
Has any man seen him with barbers?
No, but the barber's man has been seen with him.
Indeed, he looks smarter than he did.
Why has he rubbed himself with perfume? Can you not smell him on my lot?
That's as much to say the sweet youth's in love. And I know who loves him. I warrant the one that knows him not. And in despite of all his bad habits, dies for him.
She shall be buried with her face upwards.
Yet is this no charm for the toothache? Signor Leonardo, I have 8 or 9 wise words to say to you that these hobby horses must not hear.
Oh, to break with him about Beatrice.
And let's hope Hero and Margaret have done the same, so the two will not bite each other when they meet.
My lord and brother, God save you.
Good evening, brother.
If you have a moment, I would like to speak with you.
In private.
If you don't mind, Count Claudio should hear too. But what I speak of concerns him.
What's the matter?
Does your lordship mean to be married tomorrow?
You know he does.
I don't know about that.
Not if he knew what I know. If you know of any impediment, I pray you reveal it.
You may think that I don't love you. I hope that after this you will see from what I'm about to tell you that I do. My brother holds you well and endears the past, and has helped to bring about your ensuing marriage. Surely this is effort wasted and labour ill bestowed.
Why, what's the matter?
I came here to tell you. And to put it briefly, the lady is disloyal.
Who?
Hero? Even she. Your hero, Leonardo's hero, why, every man's hero.
Disloyal?
The word is too good to paint out her wickedness. I could say she were worth. Think of a work title and I will fit her to it. Let me show you further proof. If you will follow me tonight, you'll see a man with her on her balcony, even the night before her wedding day. If you love her, then tomorrow wed her. But it would better fit your honour to change your mind.
Can this be so? I cannot believe it.
You dare not trust what you see, don't admit what you know. If you will follow me tonight, I will show you enough. And when you have seen more and heard more, proceed accordingly.
If I see anything tonight, why, I should not marry her. Tomorrow, in the congregation, where I should wed her, there I will shame her. And as I have wooed you to obtain her, there I will disgrace her.
I will disparage her no further, till you are my witnesses. Go with me tonight, and let the issue show itself.
Down toward the eternal, all mischief strangely thwarted.
Oh, plague right well prevented. And so will you say when you have seen the outcome.
Grazie!
Hello. Yes, sir. Why? It's to stay alive, lost. The mock guys pretend you're about to carjack it. Everybody gonna scream and shout. You see the man put the nine to your head. Pop!
Sometimes close, and I made a man. I'm Bruce Margaret. The lady here I sent away to move by the name of Hero.
That's it?
Leaning out of Hero's chamber window. I'm telling this tale finally. I should first have told you how our master Don John arranged to set up Don Pedro and the Count Claudio underneath the window.
And they thought that Margaret was Hero?
Two of them. But the devil my master knew she was Margaret. And partly by those, which first convinced them, partly by the dark night which did deceive them, but chiefly by my villainy, which confirmed any sign that Don John had made, went away the Prince and Claudio in rage, throwing their meter at the church as appointed the next morning, and then before the whole congregation, shame with what they saw tonight, and send her home again without a husband.
Man, man, man! Call up the right masters, chief bouncer, state doggy Dumfries. We have here recovered the most dangerous piece of lechery ever known in years, and a bad dress.
Masters, masters!
Masters, don't move! Don't speak! We tried to come along.
All the luck in the world, you call me Tom, Dick and Harry.
Shut it! Here, my name ain't Harry.
Tumbling, Margaret.
Not too fast to go. You can't stand it. Yes!
Madam, cordial as officers, but in faith, if I was as tedious as a king, I could find it in the arts to bestow all on your worship.
All your tediousness on me?
In here.
Tell me what you should be saying.
Our lordship, expecting your worship's presence, has taken a couple of errant ladies and in the cellar.
Good old boy, sir. He will be talking, as they say. Well said, neighbour Burgess. Whoa. God is a good man, and if two men ride a bike, one must ride behind. But, an honest soul, honestly, yes. But all men are not alike, sadly, in it, good neighbour.
See, if he comes too short for you.
Gives that God gives.
Honestly, you.
One month, sir. Our watch, sir, having decomprehended two suspicious persons, and we would have them examined before your worship.
Take the examination yourself and bring it me. I must leave, it's a busy time to see. Drink some wine before you go. Farewell.
Right.
My lord, they're waiting for you. Your daughter's your husband.
Go on, man. Go get away to George Seacole. Ask him to bring the pennon into the jail. We have some examination needs to make.
And we'll do it well, won't we?
Aye, we will be majorly canny. I will tell you that much for free. And they better tell us what we want to hear, or else.
That's what?
Well, fucking world heinous what happened to them. No, I say, mate. Go on, go get the learned writing geezer. Write down our communication. Let's go.
I'll go this way.
Do so as you are my child.
Oh, God, defend me! How am I to say? What kind of interrogation?
to make you answer truly to your name.
Is it not Hero? Who could blot that name with any disreproach?
What man was he talked with you last night between 12 and 1? If you're a maid, answer to this!
Oh, it's all we know now that the owl, my lord!
Why, then you are no maid!
Leonato, I'm sorry you must hear this, but upon my honour, myself, my brother, and this aggrieved count did see her and hear her at that hour talk with a ruffian at the balcony, and who, like a most vile villain, I confess to thee,
is
a man
of
Come, let us go. These things come thus to light. Smother her spirits up.
Do not live, Hero. Do not open your eyes. I was sorry I only had the one child, but you were one too much for me. Why did I even have you? Why were you ever lovely in my eyes?
Sir, be patient. For my part, I am so wrapped up in wonder, I know not what to say.
Oh, my soul, my cousin is falsely accused.
Lady, were you her bedfellow last night?
No, truly not, but until last night I've had these past 12 months been her bedfellow. Confirmed, with the two princes' lies, with Claudio murdered, speaking of her boundless, washed it with tears. Hence from here, let her die.
Hear me a little. I've been silent long enough and given way to this course of fortune. By noting the lady, I've not a thousand blushing apparitions on her face. A thousand innocent shames and angel white beads where they're fluttered. And in her eyelids appear the fire to burn the oath these princes hold against my maiden truth. You call me a fool. Don't trust my observation. Reject my divine calling. If this lady were I, her guiltless under some biting error.
You see, sister, the best thing for her is not to ask her damnation the sin of lying. She does not deny it. Therefore, why do you seek to cover with excuse which appears in naked truth?
Lady, what man is it you are accused of being with?
I don't accuse me, no. I know no one. If I know more of any man's life than I should, then show me no mercy. My father, if there is any evidence that any man conversed with me in proper hours, or that I last night exchanged words with any such creature, refuse me, hate me, torture me to death.
There's some strange misunderstanding in the
passage. Two of them have the very image of honour, but if their wisdom be misled in this, origins of it lie in John the Bastard, whose spirits toil, plotting villainies.
Oh no. If they speak the truth, these hands shall tear her. But if they wrong her honour, the crowns of them shall well hear of it.
Pause a while, let my captain's plain explain you. Your daughter, hear the princess left dead. Let her want the secret be kept in, and tell her that she is dead indeed.
Why, what can comfort?
She died with much maintained, upon the instant that she was accused. She will be lamented and excused. By every hero. So will be with Claudio also. When he hears how she died upon his word, the very idea of her life should come clothed in more precious apparel, more beautifully delicate and full of life, and into the eye and prospect of his life. Then when she lived indeed, then shall he mourn and wish he had not so accused her, if he ever had love in his heart.
Signor Leonato, let the sister advise you, and though you know my close attachment and love for the prince and Claudio, I promise to act as secretly and justly in this action, as your soul should with your body.
I'm overwhelmed with grief. The smallest hope shall leave me.
It's well consented. Come, lady, glad to live. This way again, perhaps, and alone. I patiently endure.
Lady Beatrice, you wept for this while.
Lady, and I will weep for a while longer.
Don't desire that.
You have no reason. I do it freely.
Surely, I do believe your fair cousin is wrong.
And how much might the man deserve me?
Is there any way to show such friendship?
A very even way, no such friend.
No man.
It is a man's office, but not yours.
I love nothing in the world so much as you. Is that not strange?
A strange little thing I know not. It would be as possible for me to say I love nothing in the world so well as you. But don't believe me, yet I'm not lying. I confess nothing, nor deny nothing. I'm sorry for my cousin.
Why, my blade, Beatrice, you love me.
Do not swear, I'll make you eat it.
I'll swear by him that you love me, and I will make him eat it that says I love you not.
Will you not eat a word?
There's no source that can be devised. I protest, I love you.
I think God forgive me.
No offense, sweet Beatrice.
You have given me support in a hard time, and I was about to protest. I love you.
one hero.
Yes. As sure as I have a thought. Or a soul.
Enough! I will challenge you. I'll kiss your hand. By this hand, Claudio shall render me a dear account. As you hear of me, so think of me. Now go comfort your cousin, for I must say she is dead. So far.
Unter diesen Waffen wohnen.
Redemption for this. Where is the sexton? There, right down to the prince's office, sir. That me is a fool.
Away, you're an ass! You're an ass!
If only you disrespect me, man. Horace, remember, I is an ass. When you went down, yet don't forget that I is an ass. Master, you was for fighting, but I is a wise fellow. And what's more, a homer. And what's more, an officer. And what's more, I is well fit skis and I'm a senior muscle. These are outrageous. I know the law, innit?
So, how come you have been in a nick for 18 months?
Leave it! As I was saying, I was rich. I have two beams, the latest Nike Air Jordans, and I getting a diamond in two. You like to listen to me? Only six have written down the I is an ass.
Good cheer.
I'll tell you how Beatrice praised your wit the other day. I said you had a fine wit. Yes, she said, a fine little one. No, I said, a great wit. Yes, she said, a great gross one. No, said I, a good wit. Exactly, she said, it hurts nobody. Thus for an hour did she distort her particular virtues, till at last with a sigh she concluded, you're the most handsome man around.
For which she wept heartily and said she cared not.
Yes, she did, and if she did not hate him till death, she would love him dearly. But when shall we put the savage bull's horns on the sensible Benedict's head?
Yeah, with the text underneath, here dwells Benedict, the married man.
Very well, boy, you know my mind.
My lord, for your many courtesies, I thank you. I must discontinue your company. Your brother the bastard is fled from Messina, and you have among you killed a sweet and innocent young lady. For my lord Lackbeard here, he and I shall meet. Until then, peace.
He is in earnest. He is in most profound earnest. And I'll warrant you for the love of Beatrice.
This challenge you.
Most sincerely.
Did you not say my brother has fled? How now, to my brother's men bound, Ratio is wanted.
Inquire into their offence, my lord.
What offence have these men done?
Why, sir, he has committed false reports. Moreover, he's spoken the truth. Secondarily, they are slanders. Sixth and lastly, they are belied lately. Thirdly, they are verified understand, and to conclude, they are lying knaves.
Firstly, I ask you what they have done. Thirdly, I ask you what's their offence. Sixth and lastly, I ask you why they to be committed. And to conclude, what do you learn on their charge?
Rightly reason.
What offence have you men done that you are thus bound to your answer? This learned constable is too cunning to be understood. What offence have you men done?
Sweet prince, we have deceived even your very eyes, but all your wisdoms could not discover these shallow fools and brought to light, who, in the night, have heard me tell this man how Don John, your brother, incensed me to slander the lady Hero, how you saw me call Margaret in Hero's garments, how you disgraced the lady when you should have married her. My villainy they have upon record, which I would rather seal with my death than repeat to my shame. The lady is dead upon mine and my master's false accusation.
Once not this speech like iron through your blood,
I have put the poison while he uttered.
Did my brother put you to this task?
Yes, and he paid me a great deal of practice of it.
To compose and frame the treachery and spell upon his villainy.
Oh, sweet Hero. Now your image does appear in that exquisite beauty that I loved first.
Somewhere, brother, I see it somewhere now.
Not by any mistake.
By my son or I, and to satisfy this man, I'll bend under any wages and join you.
I cannot bid my daughter live, that is impossible. So pray you both inform the people of Messina how innocent she died. And if your love could bring me anything by way of elegy, hang her an epitaph upon her tomb and sing it to her bones. Sing it tonight. Tomorrow morning come to my house, and since you cannot be my son-in-law, be yet my nephew. My sister has a daughter almost a copy of my child that's dead. She alone is there to both of us. Give her the right you should have given her cousin, and there
dies
my revenge.
Oh, noble sir, your over-kindness wrings tears from me. I do embrace your offer, and from now on do as you wish with poor Claudia.
Tomorrow, then, I expect your coming. Tonight, I take my leave. This treacherous man will be brought face to face with Margaret, who I believe was
Captain Whittle, an arrant knave, wit, I beseech you, great for the example of others.
Until tomorrow morning.
God keep your worship. I wish your worship well.
Until tomorrow morning.
God restore your worship.
Until
and if by merry meeting may be wished, God prohibit it.
I'm sorry. He did not take his pills.
Until tomorrow morning, my lord. Farewell.
Well, my lord, we'll look for you tomorrow.
We will not fail. Tonight I'll mourn for you.
Bring on these fellows. We'll talk with Margaret and how our relationship grew with this new man.
Leonardo.
fell there upon thy tomb, praising her that I am thou.
Now music sound and sing your solemn hymn.
Your hand for this holy sister. I am your husband if you like it.
Okay.
hero.
Nothing more certain. One hero died a child. But I do live, and surely as I live, I am a man.
Hero? Hero that is dead?
She died, my lord, but while Mrs. Lama lived.
Call this maker, can I qualify? When asked the holy rites of Brendan, how I should turn the fool of their hero to death.
So, in fact, why? Which is Beatrice?
I ask that man, what is your will?
Do not you love me?
Why, no more than reason.
Why, then your uncle and the prince and Claudia have been deceived, for they swore you did.
Well, then, do not you love me?
What, no more than reason.
And more than my cousin and Mark Nesla are also deceived, for they swore you did.
They swore that you were almost sick for me.
They swore you were well nigh dead for me.
Then it's no such matter, you don't love me.
No, truly, only the friend. Come, mate, I'm sure you love the gentleman.
And I'll be sworn upon it that he loves her. Well, here's a piece of paper written in his hand, a halting sonnet of his own pure brain.
Here's another written in my cousin's hand, stolen from my pocket, containing my affection unto Benedict.
Thank you.
expert Nazi. The real expert master of toilet torture. And it can be a man or a woman. It's the person who uses up the whole of the bog roll, save for a single sheet, which they then drape artfully over the cardboard tube in an effort to create the impression that there's plenty left. Oh, yes, plenty left, just enough for your fingers to go straight through. Sort out the little things. Because in the long run, the truth is that the world is divided into two groups of people. Never mind men and women, never mind gay and straight, whatever divisions, forget them. The world is divided into finickies and slobs. And in a perfect world, finickies would live with finickies in a pristine, pube-free environment where the lid was always put back on the flora and there were no moldy carrots at the bottom of the fridge. And slobs would live with slobs in a slob swamp. And never the twain should meet. Unfortunately, this is not the way things are, for we are but playthings.